So you've been dating him for 6, 7, 8 years. He doesn't know where you live. He doesn't know your parents. He has not come to see your mother and your father, and you're still there. And you have 2 children already. He keeps telling you, oh, next year I'll come and knock. I'll come and, madam, pack your things and leave. He must come and see your mother. Good morning. It's Friday, and we're excited. That's the mood of the show today. Myself, AJ, and the sweet Dr. Amma. I wish I had a cake to
swallow. Oh, goodness. You needed that. But you know, the scenario you just created, I think that is witchcraft. Because you've locked the person down. You've not accepted to take the person on as your legal wife or husband. And then you're making them
But maybe the brother that doesn't have money.
No,
maybe
that one is just for
Nongukaya. I had an interview with Yala. We'll be playing next week. Okay. She said she's dating, but my
that's
crush.
Your crush.
Yeah. I have a huge.
Don't
crush
you see how he was having puppeting? Like, Angel was just not himself. Well, he was dancing all over. I was shocked. If he was white, he blushed. It was bad.
She said she's in a relationship, but she's told her significant other that until there's a ring on her finger, she's single and ready to mingle.
Okay.
If anybody comes and presents the cows,
did she name anybody? Did she name like
what's the interview?
Okay,
so why did you give us like that? Intro? Why you don't give us?
Don't mind
a
this
conclusion.
Boy. This boy,
don't
I told
here
you. You see,
on New Day.
It's like salutation.
No,
you said lies.
Anyway, so please, if you are, and if you're a man who's been doing that, what's your life?
Jenny, why are you talking about yourself? Why are you saying myself on the show?
No, it's not. This is myself.
Yeah, you're talking about yourself.
No, I. You see, I have a legacy like who in the Bible, Abraham. I'm so faithful. I stick to one woman even if
you don't go to their house.
But you know how you said myself? It just reminds me of the essays we used to write in GHS. And you know, and I realized it was a dream. They'll say write an essay and then at the end of it put those words.
End with
and
that.
People used to make up all manner of stories and it was interesting. It allowed us to be creative, but some people were just over creative. You know, in SS, I remember one of the stories, someone said she was being raped and she was raped by 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we had our English teacher reading it. So she says, hey, and then out there. Because really, if it was rape, you'd wake up after the first incident, wouldn't you? But she kept on and then went like 5 people and then
you're
she said,
the
then I woke up only to realize
fiction.
it was a dream.
You're asking
that one is terrible fiction. She has overdreamt anyway,
guys. You know those who also create stories, and AJ is a script writer.
Right.
Those who create the stories in the essay and the story never ends. So now, then they try cut corners. So it starts and said, okay, they grew up in a rich home.
Right.
They went to a preparatory school. Then they pick a day in the class and then they start going. And then the story never ends. And then all of a sudden, I realized it was a dream.
Well, the best way to always end these is with the quotes like, all that glitters is
not gold. I know.
Omegay, while the sun
shines. And you felt like you have written something. Oh, those were good days.
But speaking of which, I mean, the other time we raised the issue about the BECE, I think that we'll raise it again. So the Minister for Education, Dr. Matthew Pokuprempeh, the Ghana Education Service, and all those who are stakeholders will get to know about it. In the universities, one semester is about 3 months, maybe a little more. So what you are tried and tested on, or what you're examined on, is what you have learned in the semester.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe a few build-ups from the previous semester. Mm-hmm. In the secondary school, you get a total of a full month to write 8 papers, sometimes 7, because some people skip one of the electives. But the BEC folks, 1 week, 10 papers.
Lot.
And it doesn't add up. And you see, the 10 papers is not just what they had learned from GSS 1 to GSS 3. It's from class 1, perhaps from kindergarten, all that accumulated knowledge up to GSS 3. 9 years or 10 years, it could be more, crammed into one. And they have to write all the 10 papers in just 5 days. What kind of psychological trauma will be up on the children? And I want us to have a conversation about this, you know, firmly as a country. Maybe our people have not mentioned this to WAEC, but given the fact that we have a lot of deprived schools in Ghana, people don't even have access to the textbooks with which to learn, you know, and the AMA. And I know that some of the district assemblies have said that no extra classes. So how do the children, you know, pick it up? And it's been a great concern to me. BEC will come up sometime May or April, thereabout. But we have time to start talking about these things. At least if we can extend it for 2 weeks, we could do a day more or two so we can give them. Writing 2 papers in a day,
that's a lot.
That's no joke. And that's the determining factor of their lives, getting into a good secondary school or a secondary school. Now, if you fail your BEC, what becomes of you?
Certainly.
But who fail BEC?
AJ, it's time for news. Take us away with your news.
All right, the news coming up shortly. Hello, good morning. My name is Anthony Jackson. Time now for the morning news. Now, Vice President Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia has arrived home after a 2-week medical leave. He is expected to begin official work on Monday, February 6.
The Vice President arrived in the company of his wife, Samira Bawumia. He was welcomed by the President, Nana Akufo-Addo, the Chief of Staff, Remoso Opare, the Senior Minister, Yosafu Mafo, and other government ministers and some party dignitaries. The Vice President, Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia, who appeared elated, exchanged pleasantries with government functionaries. Minister of Information, Dr. Mustafa Hamid, was happy for his health and expressed worry over concerns that he had been struck by a stroke.
In the name of politics, I mean, people can wish people dead, people can wish that people were poisoned, or people can wish that people got strokes, and etc., etc. I found that rather very, very, very sad. But by and large, the end justifies the means. At the end of the day, the man has come back.
He again rejected claims that government erred in issuing a statement on the health status of the vice president.
On the day that we put out that statement that he had fallen ill, he was supposed to meet with international visitors, there were engagements that he had in the public space, and etc., etc. I mean, really, the rules of decency require that you tell these people that, look, he's been unwell, and therefore he's not going to be able to perform those duties. So it was perfectly normal for us to do. Beyond that is what is not done. In other words, to have said that he's suffering of such and such an ailment, that one you don't qualify to say that.
Secretary to the Vice President, Dr. Gideon Buakou, said Dr. Bawumia is expected to begin work on Monday.
President will be traveling tomorrow morning, and it is likely he may have to come and escort the President to the airport. And that may be deemed as part of the official work, but I think wholly Monday should be the official day for him to start work.
He also thanked Ghanaians for their prayers.
Me, as a Christian, I accept all comments that come from people, and we believe that God is the ultimate decider on the health and the life of individuals.
Now, President Akufo-Addo has suspended the Upper West Regional Minister, Alhaji Suleiman Hassan, for allegedly shielding thugs who attacked officials of NADMO in the region, staff of the National Disaster Management Organization, who accused the minister of protecting hooligans, have vowed not to work again until the attackers, believed to be members of the governing New Patriotic Party, are arrested. A statement from the presidency said the minister has been suspended with immediate effect. The statement signed by the Director of Communications at the Presidency, Eugene Ahin, said President Akufo-Addo reiterates his commitment to the application of the laws of the land, which must occur without fear or favor, affection or ill will, and without recourse to the political, religious or ethnic affiliations of any citizen of the land. The Deputy Upper West Regional Minister, Amidu Ishak, is to act as the regional minister in the interim pending the conclusion of the investigation. Now, three alleged armed robbers have been gunned down during a gun battle with the police at Weja. The deceased had attacked an undercover police patrol team in an attempt to snatch their vehicle amidst firing of gunshots. Viewer discretion is advised.
The three, Kwame Salsa, Jaru and Joe, the police alleged have been on their wanted list for varying crimes in the Greater Accra and Central regions for the past 3 months. The alleged gang of armed criminals were noted for high-profile robberies and car snatching in and around Bawe, Botiano, Kokrobite and Kaswa. One of the latest crimes, according to the Accra Regional Police Commander DCOP George Alex Mensah, was an attack on a Range Rover which they failed to drive away due to the security restriction on the vehicle. However, the police said the criminals made away with some valuables and an unspecified amount of money. DCOP George Alex Mensah said luck eluded the gang when they mistook the police operation car to be a civilian vehicle in the wee hours of Thursday, February 1. The police returned fire, killing all three in the process. A locally manufactured double-barrel pistol with 9 rounds of BB cartridges, a foreign pistol with 5 rounds of 9mm ammunition, 5 mobile phones and an iPad belonging to the owner of the Range Rover were found on the deceased.
We want to sound this warning or note of caution to all those who are engaged in similar activities, that the police will not sit down for them to perpetrate this crime unconcerned. We are now going to match them boot for boot and, if possible, get them out of the system.
The Regional Police Commander, DCOP Alex Mensah, also urged the public to support the police deal with criminal elements.
Member of Parliament for Subin Eugene Entry has expressed worry over the recent secret recording of voice and videos usually being posted on social media. The lawmaker wants the country's laws on privacy strengthened and legislation crafted to punish offenders.
With the proliferation of smartphones, recording of telephone and other conversations had become the order of the day. Almost each day, people are being subjected to secret recordings and even private video recording, which sometimes find their way on social media. The incidence of sexual or pornographic materials on social media, according to MPs, defiles the rights of the parties involved. Some members of parliament want people sensitized on the subject.
We need to reiterate and give a strong condemnation where we need to draw the line between what is acceptable, what is the norm, and what is palatable to share with the public. And people have lost their lives as a result of this misconstrued sharing of data unintended for the public.
I am in full support of this call that yes, there are some of the existing legislations concerning this matter, but there are no sanctions or penal regimes covering them when somebody breaches them. So it is important that as a house, we take a holistic view of matters, because social media has become a very important medium of communication.
Minority leader Haruna Idrisu says most Ghanaians are abusing the mobile phone and its usage.
The best way to avoid being scandalized on this is self-discipline. Privacy must be protected and respected, but I'm afraid legislation may not be able to resolve it. We must just ensure cautious use of the mobile phone.
The majority leader says the current situation is jeopardizing national security.
What people do is a clear breach of Article 41. Legitimate interests of others, and generally refrain from doing acts detrimental to the welfare of other persons. Clearly an obvious breach of Article 41. And we say we should fold our arms as a parliament and not do anything. Mr. Speaker, so there are matters that should concern us.
The MP who raised the matter on the floor, Eugene Entry, wants a legislation crafted so offenders could be punished.
I don't think a thriving democracy like ours needs this kind of culture and practice. It's very bad, it's unethical, it's cruel, it's crude, it's depravity. There are already probably laws on the statute books, but we must look at tightening the laws by having in place a very rigorous, regimented punishment system in place as a form of deterrence.
And a 5-member ad hoc committee probing the cash for seats saga will finally lay its report in Parliament on today, February the 2nd, and to be debated next week, Tuesday. Spokesperson for the committee, Yabo Abeyansamoa, says they could not receive certain documents to enable them complete the report on time. He spoke with Evelyn Tingma.
You were supposed to present your report yesterday. What happened?
We are still polishing it, tying up a few loose ends. As I've had occasion to observe to Sister Media House, a couple of documents we're expecting delayed a bit, so it held the whole report up. And now we have our full complement of supporting documents, and we've gone through our drafts, and God willing, I believe tomorrow we will lay it in the House.
Didn't you know about that?
Yeah, people were supposed to supply the documents at a time we believed they would be able to. And they were held up, not through our fault, but through those who were supposed to organize and bring those reports. So it's not a question of me having promised the last time, so yesterday I have to be held to it. It's exigency, it's human intervention.
Majority Leader did indicate that you will lay it tomorrow and then it will be debated on Tuesday. Why wouldn't it be debated tomorrow after laying it?
The rules are in that structure. But ideally, why not ask a Majority Leader?
You are the spokesperson for the committee.
Yes, the rules, the way the rules are designed, you lay it and then we retreat, share copies of it, it's 48 hours and then we debate it.
Initially, the committee was supposed to have presented its report on January 24, but asked for more time. They were then given up to January 31, but could also not meet that deadline. The 5-member ad hoc committee was set up to probe allegations by some minority MPs that some expatriates businessmen paid up to $10,000 to sit close to the president during the Expatriate Business Awards ceremony held in Accra last year, December.
Now to the world of business. Prices of petroleum products are likely to remain stable if government applies the National Petroleum Authority's price stabilization mechanism. Prices are expected to go up at the pumps by 2% for the first pricing window in February, but this will not happen if government intervenes.
Prices on the world market went up by 2.76% from its previous average of $67.70 per barrel. Currently, price of Brent crude on the market is $69.57 per barrel. The city's marginal depreciation also contributed to this 2% increase expected to hit the market. With these factors, prices are expected to increase at the pumps.
From December 1st, 2017, government kick-started the price stabilization mechanism, where the price stabilization and recovery levy is used to manage prices. So where prices are going up and government feels that it should step in to make sure it doesn't go up so the consumer can have some respite, government decides to intervene by stabilizing it or ordinarily we say by using that fund to subsidize what the price will be. So if government decides to apply the price stabilization mechanism this time around, that means consumers will be saved from the imminent prices that are supposed to go up.
Richmond Roxon, principal research analyst with the IES, says government intervention will, however, not be enough as this goes round to hurt profits of oil marketing companies.
Sometimes government intervention is not enough. What it means is that the OMCs will have to swallow part of the cost, and already some of them are complaining about the cost that they are making losses because of the application of the price stabilization and recovery levy. Most of them look at the larger OMCs who, because of volume sometimes, will decide to rescind their decision to increase. But if a relatively smaller OMC with not much volumes, when these decisions are taken, sometimes you get affected.
And that's it for news this morning. New Day continues after this break.
Welcome back. Let's do some newspaper headlines now. We'll start off with Ghanaian Times. It says the Upper West Regional Minister, Mr. Sulemana Al-Hassan, has been suspended. Also, Finance Minister is to sue Shraj over the $2.2 billion case. And then court has referred the 4 million NCA case to the Supreme Court. And then finally, AMA has sacked 11 members of the task force for extortion. Certainly, that has to be lauded. It seems like everyone seems to be cracking the whip in their various departments.
I think that the the sacking of the, or the suspension rather, of the Upper West Regional Minister has come, you know, people say, well, the president has done well. But we hope that it doesn't become just this one. If we hear of people who have done things and we're able to ascertain, let's set them aside and deal with the issues. But it would want to fit into the theory where the minority is asking for the head of the finance minister. He says he is going to sue Shraj for that. But there's also DIMOC, Democratic Youth, certain organization that are in court over this particular matter as well. So it doesn't, look as if it's going away, but as always, we will have different opinions about whether the man should have been allowed to work or whether he should have been suspended, whichever it is. The president is a magnanimous benefactor. He decides to appoint, hire and fire. He doesn't have to explain anything to anybody by our laws. So let him do his work.
But I mean, if what happened on the ground and being reported is the truth, then of course I agree that the president must have suspended him and is in the right direction, because Johnny, this was in the full glare of everybody. They saw him intervene in, you know, the police arresting these violent MPP supporters who raided the NADMO office. And so certainly at that point, if we think, we all do agree that we have said time and again that their government officials should not intervene when the police is doing their work, because we're the same people who come back to chastise the police for not, you know, doing what they had to do, and why do you allow politicians to pull your strings, because you are supposed to be neutral and you're supposed to protect all of us. And so if you as a parliamentarian or as a minister, you are supposed to uphold the laws of this land and you know better, you are supposed to teach citizenry how to do things, set the pace. And if you are then on the other side of it, then certainly your boss has to deal with you. And I'm glad that the president decided to at least set him aside, let investigations take place. If we find that he really, there was a wrongdoing, then he will be asked to proceed, probably be sacked from that position and given to someone else. And so I think he is laudable, and we'll see what the result from that will be.
The vice president is back home. It does put finality, or brings finality, or settles the dust on what speculations people had about the vice president. However, I have a little letter for the vice president. Good morning, vice president. I am happy that you are in good health. Yesterday I saw you and you hugged a lot of people, even though some people have said that, well, the numbers were too huge, and so I've come to welcome you. Well, I take a different view. I think that, well, in Africa, we live by a communal spirit. But I'm happy that you're in good health, Mr. Vice President. And thank you for coming home in good time, as you said. And we hope that you get back to work on Monday. But while you were ill, while many Ghanaians prayed for you, and while everybody wished that and hoped that you would get better, there was one major concern. The major concern as to whether you trust the system or not, as to whether we have the men and the equipment to deal with whatever situation, medical or not, as to whether all ordinary Ghanaians will be able to also travel out if they have whatever ailment. We have not been told, we don't know, and perhaps for confidentiality's sake, we may not want to know. But should it happen to any other ordinary Ghanaian, are they able to travel out in trying to get a serene atmosphere to rest away from family and friends, like you were told to travel out? Are ordinary Ghanaians who queue to vote for politicians like you and others able to afford this kind of thing? This is my plea. The people have dared you. They have said that, well, you wasted the money of the state and all of that. But the most important thing is, if that's what they say is not true, prove them wrong. So can you make a pledge, Mr. Vice President? I know you're very active on Twitter. I'm your friend on Twitter. Can you make a pledge that moving forward, you yourself, perhaps the president, and all other government appointees will endeavor to stay here, because one, we have the facilities, as we've been told over and over again, because we have the men, We have the doctors, all the professionals who travel out to go and offer service, because we have the equipment, because treatment here is affordable, and because we know we can get care and attention if we access medical care here. Can you promise us, Mr. Vice President, and this is a very passionate appeal to you, on behalf of many Ghanaians who will not get the opportunity to speak to you, like I'm privileged to do, that in future, we will not have such things. It's a passionate appeal. Because if we say we have the men, we have the equipment, we have the facilities, we have the infrastructure, we have everything, can you, Mr. Vice President, and this one, it's Ghanaians that are asking, I'm re-echoing their voice, also on my own accord, can you make a passionate pledge to us that we will not have this? Because the conversations flowing out of it and the speculations that came out of it because of your absence, I don't know. So, Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, how far? Good morning.
Anyway, let's touch on Daily Heritage, because there's a story we carried oftentimes, but it hasn't gotten traction as deserves. It says torture. Pupils write class test on the floor at Tebu Basic School. And this, for many people who don't know, is a school right here in Greater Accra Region. Johnny, I mean, why should people in this 24th century still be, 21st century, I mean, still be sitting on the floor? There's no chair. It says that PTA donated some amount of desks. That's about 20. But the students in that school number about 400. And so, obviously, there is a disadvantage to them, because then only 20 people get to sit on a chair, or even sometimes they share. But that is not enough. It's not adequate. And these children are going to be, you know, exposed to all health dangers of all sorts, because bending over, we know, even those of us who sit in chairs, we complain of back aches and all that, but we have young children as they are bending over, stooping over to write for the number of hours that they are there. And this is not the environment under which you need to be taught, because at the end of the day, you are even tired just by, you know, stooping over. How long will it take to raise your head, also cast your glare on the, you know, blackboard, then you go back? All that is even not, you don't have enough concentration to accumulate all that you're being taught.
The pain,
It's very disheartening. No child has to go through this again. You'd ask, will any of our ministers allow their children to go through this?
No.
Is it because none of their children attend basic school, Tebu Basic School, and that's why this has been going on for this long?
It's I must place on record that this Tebu Basic School story is an original from TV3. Solis Rose Quartier and the team went out there, and we've chased the story for over a year. The promises we've gotten over time was that, oh, we're going to fix it. Give us a week, it will be fixed. So we're told the chairs will be fixed. The classroom is actually under a shed, not a classroom. So it's a story that TV3 has chased over and over again. Solis Rose Quartier has been out there in the cold with the children. Amma is a medical doctor, so perhaps she'll be able to tell us what the pain and the after effects will be on the children later, psychological and all of that. But this certainly should not be happening. It should not be happening around the time when we have free SHS. It should not be happening, because, you know, these children will be the same people who will graduate and feed into the secondary schools. If they have a backlog, if they have a disadvantage at that basic level, how do we expect them to perform well at the secondary level to even make it into the tertiary level? Of which committee I know that Professor Yanka and his folks are come together to decide and make plans as to how they can all be absorbed. So let's fix the foundation right, because if the foundation is not pop up, the roof, the building will crumple, it will collapse. And this is a passionate appeal, a very passionate one. Maybe the Minister of Education is not watching. Please, if you know the Minister for Education, Dr. Matthew Opoku-Prempeh, say a good morning to him on our behalf and remind him that this is not acceptable. Also remind him that in the Esikuma Odobin-Brakwa district, last year, there was a building that collapsed. Six children, kindergarten children, lost their lives. Six of them lost their lives. Nobody has been brought to book, at least as we know. Nobody has been brought to book. We were told that a new building will be constructed for them. I don't know if that has happened. We don't know. We have not seen it. So these are critical issues. Education is very, very important, and we should not be joking with it. We should not be joking with it at all. But there's a good story on the portals, and we would like to share with you. Community Connect, in fact, New Day broke the story of what looks like a mess out there. So we rescued the folks at Cantamantum. You take a look at this. This is what we're talking about. journalism that helps. So we got a distress call that this sewage that's leaking, it's around the the Grand View Hotel at Cantamantel. Those of you who trade around there, you know. So we got called, and then we went in. We called the AMA as well. And this is sewerage. Sorry if I'm messing up your breakfast, but this is it. And now this is the story. It's been fixed. It stopped leaking. But Oliver Twist will always ask for more. To our friends at the AMA, Mayor Nia Jesua, Gilbert Ankra, you see, the place has not been properly cemented. So it becomes a trap for those who do not know the terrain, those who may want to walk around there at night. And we need to look at it. But this was how it was, and this is how it's become. See, result-oriented journalism. That's what we're talking about. It's not they said, he said, she said, and then we end the story. Mm-hmm. In fact, we should be able to share with you. Okay, that's a bit of the video, how it looks like now. That's the Grand View Hotel area at the UTC Cantamantel, link towards the arena area. So it's been fixed as we speak, and it looks great there. So you know where to look when you have concerns. And it's no accident that the GJA, the Ghana Journalist Association, thinks that New Day is the best morning show, and Community Connect also radio development show. See how it is. This is it. But we're grateful that we've been able to salvage the situation. And we thank all of you for your support and willingness. Amma, we're ranting.
And certainly we are ranting. And as you know, Johnny, rightly so, you use social media absolutely to get this done. And this has got traction because people then also understand what you're doing over time. But the advantages and disadvantages of social media, and that's the question we are asking. What for it does it mean to you? Because recently there's also been too many nude pictures being leaked out.
Too many. Too many
people exposing all manner of things. People doing all manner of crazy things and putting it up on social media. So really, what are the advantages and disadvantages of social media for you and me? Hanel runs with the people out there.
Super.
Hello and welcome to Daily Rant. Today we'll be discussing the advantages and disadvantages of social media. Do join us on our various social media platforms with your comments. My name is Hanel Abalami Adokta. Keep watching Daily Rant. How has social media really affected us as people, like our societal interactions? Before, so many people, some people even got their wives through, like in taxis, through interactions. But now wherever you go, it's like everybody's busy on the phone, doing God knows what. I mean, how has social media affected us?
I would say social media, it has affected positively. It's made things easier. Simply because, you know, before I have to, you know, see a lady, if I can't approach, I have to see someone, help me talk to this lady. But now with social media, all I need is your account name. Either Facebook, Twitter, any of them, all I need is just your name, I go there, I try to add you up.
So you prefer to hide behind social media?
Oh yeah, no, I will take it from there. I will chat you from there. When I see the interest, it gives me the morale, the vim. Then from there, I can meet you in person, then we take it. You know, from there, and then we move on.
Okay.
I don't think it has helped the society at large, because I don't know, social media has actually made nonsense of our traditions and cultures. Okay. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, well, what do you mean exactly? Like,
because we have no respect for elders anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody can hide behind any picture and then speak trash.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
Knowing very well that personally we see the person, he cannot even say anything.
Or they'll hide behind fake names, fake accounts.
Like CD accounts and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then say their mind and stuff like that. So I think that in all, yes, me, for me personally, I think it has not helped us as people, like for instance in Africa. You know, it has made nonsense of our tradition, our culture, we don't respect anyone at all.
So you don't see anything good at all from social media?
I'm not saying I don't see anything good at all at social media. You know, in terms of businesses, social media is okay. You know, you reach a lot of people.
Gives you mileage.
You can reach a lot of thousands. What you can go and buy, probably, if I want to make an advert on TV, it will cost me a lot. You understand? But social media...
The question here is, if
something is making your culture look foolish. How then again do you say you reach your target market?
And I'm saying that when it comes to business, I'm talking about business. Listen to me, I'm not...
Why is business not, like business is not part of our culture?
He's
separating the two.
How?
You know, he's separating the two.
Because... Let him understand.
Okay.
Let him understand.
Madam.
Okay,
tell you something. I would say social media is good. Because even my son, 4 years boy, even know what is called Zenda.
Okay.
Zenda and those things, Facebook and WhatsApp and those, even though Facebook.
Yes.
But when he's on Facebook, is there anyone who regulates him?
No, no.
Because we know that there are some things on Facebook that it's not actually child friendly.
Yeah.
You know, you are there, you are scrolling through, and then some pop-ups are coming. It's not really healthy for the kid. So is someone really regulating him?
It's when even helping me.
Hey.
Yeah, because through social media, I would say, I've been learning much.
Yes.
Okay, well, so what actually have you learned from social media?
I haven't learned that even our vice president is in UK.
Yes.
He's sick.
Yes.
Oh, but that one,
I know it's through Facebook. I saw him on Facebook. He and his wife walking, and some people asking him, hey, this is the vice president. Ghana vice, you see. We learn all this from social media. So
see, social
it's good.
It has come and collapsed. Our morals as people.
Okay.
You understand?
Okay.
See, let me tell you something. Social media, you wake up in the morning, you go on Facebook, the free thing, what's on your mind?
Yes.
Okay. No, I want to die. You understand? You see, in those times when there are no social media, you know, we the way you speak to an elderly person, you understand? The way we go about things. When you see a lady and you want to approach, you want to find the background of the lady before you even want to make a move.
Yeah.
You want to speak to your dad, your mom, you know, your family, they will go and make background. So you could see that our mothers and our fathers, their marriage was so attractive.
Okay.
You understand? But now, we are urinating anywhere. Anywhere you see a lady. Last time I saw a lady walking home. Excuse me, say it was crippled.
Okay.
And the kind of pictures he was taking. Honestly, I tell you that.
So,
you want to come in?
Yeah, I want to come in. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I believe social media is good. It has advantages and disadvantages, no doubt. For instance, let's assume I have a mobile phone and someone calls me and I begin to lie. What has the phone got to do with the lying? It has to do with attitude now. You see, people have chosen to lie. Yeah, and recently too, I've read a lot.
People have not chosen to lie. The device is making people lie.
The device doesn't make people lie.
Ah, how?
No.
If I have the device and I have to lie, I'll lie. Because the device is making me lie.
But before the device or before social media, we had liars in the
society. That's why we have, Wikipedia and those things.
No.
You can't lie.
No, okay.
Don't say.
So, okay, so do you think that social media has kind of brought some pressure onto people? Because people live kind of like fake lives on social media. So you see them and you're like, oh, this person has an iPhone, this person has this kind of car, so I want to also get this kind of car.
I have a friend.
I think a lot of people are not working hard.
The only pressure I see social media bringing into the system is pressure against the communication sectors. Like TV3, all the network sectors. Social media is bringing like a whole lot of pressure because now communication is easy. I don't need to depend on TV.
Yeah.
I don't need to depend on radio.
We have social media platforms.
Very good.
Help us get money.
So you understand?
So that's one advantage.
Yes, if I am supposed to, like I'm following TV3 on Facebook or Twitter.
Okay.
If there is any information, I easily get it there before TV3 announce it in the morning.
Okay.
Because sometimes I wake up at dawn.
We've all heard of peer influence, right?
Peer influence.
Yes, like right now, let's say we are all friends.
Yes.
Then maybe you've traveled. Maybe you're not really making it big where you've traveled.
Yes.
But maybe you go and stand by someone's car and then I'm here and I feel like I'm not doing anything. Because you're giving me pressure on social media, it looks like you have it all together.
Yes.
You
see? Instead of working hard,
most people want to use a shortcut.
Now, social media has given the juju men and the man the opportunity to reach us. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They are reaching us.
Yeah.
You open your this thing and you say, Mala, GBD, Mala, Famico.
I don't support you.
No, you know, first, we had the notion that these kind of people, they were like inside the bush, inside the forest.
Yeah, they don't come out.
They are not
social media, but now they are on social media.
Their numbers, everything.
But I don't support him.
Okay.
What I'm saying, I don't support him.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know, through social media now, most of our brothers have gotten opportunity outside.
Yes.
Do you know that? Same social media.
Even pastors meet their wives on social media. Do you know that? Most of our people.
Yes.
So don't say you don't. No, you are wrong. It's wrong.
People live double life on social media.
All right.
You understand?
Yes.
You see a lady, fine girl, on social media.
Mm-hmm.
See. She has edited the picture.
My friend.
So to extend that, whenever you see her personally, yeah. You're like, no. This is the person I've seen.
I saw, yeah.
You see? Listen. Okay. When it comes to the editing,
okay.
Even in real life, we edit ourselves. What are editing?
No, right now, he has
makeup.
Makeup.
Having the makeup.
Yes. Is that not editing in person?
Okay.
That is editing.
What about the guys? What about the guys that, you know, their pictures, and then biceps and triceps. But you see them in real life, and they're not looking the way you think they are supposed to look like. No.
Social media is not like.
Basically, it still boils down to the same argument I'm making.
Yeah.
It has to do with the choice.
Mm-hmm.
Personally, you see, when you want to live a double life, that has got nothing to do with social media. It is your own lifestyle. Okay.
You know, social media gives you the platform.
All right.
To show the other side of you.
Which other side?
Right now, before social media, all these slave queens and whatever we used to see,
it wasn't really there.
Because there was no platform for them to showcase.
The problem I have with
it's a choice. You know.
Okay.
Yes.
Now we have the digital boxes and stuff.
Yes.
So once you have that antenna or whatever, and you want to choose a particular station you want to follow, it is up to you.
Yeah.
You don't want to. You don't tell me because there is a station that advertises juju men and stuff. So everybody is watching it. No, it's a choice. You know, it's a very choice. The same social media people in America, Europe are using it for something good.
Yeah.
What is the difference? It has to do with the way we think, our minds.
See,
so
I have a problem with it. Listen, the problem
is not about
attitudinal problem.
Okay.
You understand? It's about we reaching, like people reaching us with things that we don't need.
Okay.
You see, you understand?
Listen, from the negative aspect of it.
You shouldn't only look at the negative.
Right now, a lot of children are really not reading.
Okay.
So it's affecting their grammar, it's affecting their education. They spend so much time on social media, looking at pictures, looking at videos, looking at people, and they're aspiring to be like them without putting the work to be like those people.
All right, so
the country now,
right now, everybody wants to be like Dangote, everybody wants to be rich.
Yes, that's
but
a good thing.
What have you done?
All right.
What work have you put in to be like him? You see?
Yeah, in terms of the minors,
yeah.
You know, having access to social media. It's a serious problem.
It's a serious problem
in the sense that, you know, there are all manner of, you know, things on social media. Some are not supposed to be, you know, exposed to the little ones. But then this is the situation where children's parents will have to come in.
Yes.
There's a good scripture in the Bible that says, train up a child
in the way he goes,
so that when he grows up, he will not depart from me.
Yeah.
You see, the parents are equally part to be blamed. For instance, look at what happened in one of the schools recently, where the sex, whatever, escape was, you know, exposed. It's very bad, you know. I don't know how the government is able to come in, but if it can be regulated. In other countries, I know they are able to trace.
But do you want to tell me that the girl learned from social media? What happened? Do you want to tell me that?
No, he did.
She might not learn from social media.
But the one who took the distance, if it hadn't because of social media, they wouldn't have at least, you know, viral on that social, you know, very bad. So I believe parents should come in. And the government also has a way of regulating it. Why not?
Okay.
They have to, especially kids. Even, you know, we have a cafe here. We monitor minors from not accessing. You know, there is a time that we allow them to come in for the purposes of studying or research. But beyond that, there are certain, you know, sites we don't allow them to, you know.
I know some people, because they want to make money.
That is the issue.
They don't care.
That is the issue.
You know, they don't regulate.
Recently, if you don't.
Yeah.
You see, my point is that, you know, in the days of old, Our family have good times. They have quality times together. You know, you see that a dad, they don't have much, but the family is together. You understand? But now,
social media, you see the father sitting down,
watching the phone.
This country, we are looking for entrepreneurs.
The son is also watching.
We want to hear the under-20s entrepreneurs, under-23 entrepreneurs. The only thing we need to, you know, teach our kids is they should go online, read from, you know, useful sites, like the useful aspect of the social media. We shouldn't allow them create account
where they will have access to these pornographic things.
Social media has come to destroy the very fiber of the society.
It's helping the society to
you learn. Understand?
Yes.
It has come.
We are learning
to
from it.
Destroy thank the you kids. Very much. It has come. Don't say, you know, it has destroyed everything that we know. That is true.
Yes. For me, understand? For me, it's uh-huh.
So
am,
for me,
we are
I am against it. For me, I'm against it.
Yes, for me, no of Obama me. And those exactly. Donald me. Trump yes. And those by Jackson. If you know social media, do you know them? You don't know them.
You see,
that's what I'm saying. My small boy, four years boy.
See,
okay. No Zenda.
Forget about.
He knows about Zenda.
Forget about Zenda. I'm telling you that the moment you are not there and you hear that, there's a promo something on Facebook. You will take your
okay. So you've there. Seen and you've heard it all on social media. Others are for it, others are against it. What do we do about this situation? This is Daily Rant. Let's keep chatting.
Welcome back and thank you very much for joining us. The Ghanaian Times this morning says Finance Minister to sue Shraj over 2.25 billion case. Court refers $4 million NTA case to Supreme Court. And AMA sacks 11 tax force members for extortion. Upper West Regional Minister suspended. The Daily Heritage says torture. Pupils write class test on the floor at Table Basic School. And the Daily Graphic says, Veep back from medical leave. President cracks the whip. Suspends Upper West Regional Minister over NADMO attack. McDan lauds government's economic policies. And Ken Ofereta heads for court. He challenges portions of Shraj report on $2.25 billion bond. The Daily Guide says, Ofereta to sue Shraj. And Baumia is back. Nana fires minister over NADMO attack. Finally, the Daily Statement says, President suspends Upper West minister. Put Ash Wednesday over Valentine. Top U.S. Catholic bishop hedges. And best Ghana best investment destination. World-renowned financial analyst affirms. And NDC funny, confused. As MPP couples descend on the minority over the 2.25 billion bond. My guest this morning to do the conversation, the Greater Accra Regional Chairman of the National Democratic Congress, Mr. Adekoka. Chief, good morning, and Happy New Year to you.
Same to you.
I have not seen you this year.
Honestly.
New Year resolutions?
Well, we are still holding on to them.
give us one, at least. Richard gave us one the other time, and I'll be checking up on him.
I see. You've caught me panting. The New Year's resolution is that we must have all of us must have peace in this country, especially on the security front. But let me say good morning to your viewers and Richard. I've been watching Richard from afar, and I'm going to be an advocate for him this morning. That this is a gentleman who seems to be have been left in the wilderness. It's about time.
He's not complaining, oh. Richard. Are you complaining?
I'm not saying he's complaining.
Okay.
I'm putting a word for him.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay.
That's a hardworking gentleman, and I believe that we must reward young guys who are hardworking. Right. So, if the president is watching, I saw his motorcade coming.
Right.
Yeah, I think he's going to flag stuff. He's just watching this morning. The next reshuffle.
You should fix him somewhere. Okay.
That's my New Year resolution.
Richard, where do you want to go? That's your New Year resolution. Richard, where do you want to go?
I've missed my uncle. I think he's missing in action. And I think what it is that as a country and as a party in government, I think whatever we need to do to make sure we provide the people the sort of promises that we made to them in run up to the elections. That should be our ultimate goal. After putting up together a team to serve the country, I think we do so at the pleasure of the government. I think that whatever role that we've been assigned to do in terms of speaking for the government in various capacities and also assisting our political party and strengthening the party and its grassroots, I think we'll be ready to work and assist the government and the team of ministers, including the information ministry and other amazing individuals that will continuously cooperate and collaborate with in working to make sure that we deliver real deliverables to the good people of this country.
Yeah, yesterday you were in Tema, Richard, the Kaiser building demolition. I saw you there actively participating. What's the latest?
I think by the grace of God and through the conversation with the people who reside in those facilities, we've been able to indicate to them the desire of the government and the president, Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, to take care of their lives. Mm. What it is that the ultimate importance of this whole exercise was to make sure that we protect the lives of the people who reside in those facilities. Mm. Upon the court's judgment on 28th of October 2013, that indicates that based on the AESL report, that says that if these people are not asked to vacate the facility, I mean, a country will wake up one morning expressing condolences to families and also crying over spilt milk. Because the issue was that, looking at the nature of the facility, if government has not been prudent, if TDC had not been prudent, if NADMO and other security agencies, including BNI and other agencies and the police that we continue to collaborate with, if they had not been prudent in coming to help in trying to talk to our people. But the point is, these are citizens of the land that need to be taken care of. So we needed to let them understand the need for them to vacate before the building.
So where are they now? Where are they going now?
I think what has been done over the period was that, because this whole exercise started even as far back as 20 years ago, that those indications were sent to them. Because these people were residing in there for the past 60 years, and they were during those times, they were paying grounds rent out to the TDC. But as far back as 20 years ago, they ceased paying those grounds rent out, or TDC stopped taking those ground rent out, where they realized that the structure integrity of those facilities were quite in great doubt. Okay. And if same is allowed, and people are allowed to inhabit in it, because we're literally a sitting death trap. Mm. If they continue to take money from them, it means that they were literally legalizing the stay of such people, and their lives were being compromised. Mm. So they stopped taking ground rent. But when TDC decided to take and repossess the place and also demolish it or look for ways of taking off the structure from the place, they decided to compensate our members or the people of this country who reside in those areas. Mm. Some of them were given lands and other things. We know that some of them have sold the lands entirely.
So they've been sorted out?
Oh, they've been,
Why were they still there?
I mean, some of these questions, some of the people, when they took the land, they sold it and took the money off. Some took the land, divided into two, sold a part and used it to build. Some of them have built their house that even rented some. Mm. Some too sold it entirely and took their money and still came to live there. So obviously, a chunk of the people who were staying in that facility have vacated. It was left with some few individuals that we needed to talk to and let them understand that we didn't want...
What was their reaction yesterday?
I mean, they received it because we didn't want the Mekong incident. Remember a year ago, a school building collapsed on a 6 kids in the voter
room. Nobody has been held accountable anyway.
This case could have grown to become ankle this in society, who have paid their dues to society, could have become the next Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, your good self.
But nobody has been held accountable for that.
So these are the
minister made a promise then, but nobody has been held accountable.
These are the difficulties. The point is that no matter the accountability that individuals will be held to, at the end of the day, you cannot return the lives of such individuals.
Wrap up for me. When are we seeing a finality of the demolition and perhaps the start of the project?
I think the plans of TDC and the stakeholders involved, especially that we hadn't declared the place as a disaster zone, is that ASAP, as soon as possible, this ought to happen. Because the point is that beyond those who reside in the facility, there will be passerbys. It could collapse any time,
right?
Any small storm, any small tremor or shake, that property.
ASAP is no timeline, Richard.
See, the reason why I cannot sit here and give you a tentative date is that I don't literally work with a TDC.
But I saw you there. Were you reflectors?
Because the idea was that what was important was the lives of our people.
Right.
We needed to protect the life first. Mm. After the building, it was
so you have not seen the roadmap.
I've seen things, but the point is that I'm not sure it's up to me for me to make those things public. We need to allow TDC, the body that has been mandated by the state, to look at this issue and see how we can provide fruitful solution to the various difficulties that confront the area. But their plans is that they are going to collapse the building. They are partnering with some investors and using the land over there as their equity and reconstruct the place. And the people who are living there, those who have not been able to secure themselves properties, will be given first option of purchase, which is quite good. And I think that this is what we need to do to assist our people.
Mr. Koka, step in here for me. So some have said that we should put a human face to this, but now he's raising concerns that people have been compensated and all of that. What do you make of what's happening out there at Kaiser Flats?
You see, my take is that of the culture of what do you call it, maintenance. Mm. Over the years, probably, I don't know the foundation of that building, but probably if over the years, whoever was in charge was maintaining the property, I think you go to certain countries, properties have, buildings have stood up for over 50, 100 years,
right,
and they are still solid.
Right.
So that what we should be talking about is the culture of maintenance.
In fact, the Cathedral Church of the Most Holy Trinity has been there for over 100 years.
Over 100 years, you understand? Mm. So the question is, we've come this far because of culture of maintenance. Over the years, if TDC was collecting a ground rent,
right,
were they maintaining the place? Mm. They were. Now you are going to bring down the whole edifice and put up a new one. It's in the right order, but the human face as well. But if they've been compensated over the year, which I know because I've been involved in this this project for a very long time, when government won the case against them, absolutely, and they refused to move out, and we realized that they've been paid compensation.
Right.
So if they've been paid compensation, and like Richard said, if people are given land and someone have sold them, then the human face element is eliminated,
right,
because you've been taken care of, but you have not made use of what was given to you. Exactly. Right. So let's see how it plays out. There are other structures there which also needs to be brought down, because the whole area is really a disaster zone, and we don't want to wait one day we wake up and as usual we politicians who troop there and make the photo opportunities and after 2 days, 3 days we leave, but lives might have been lost. Mm. So we need to be proactive, and I think if they must also be given the assurance that once the project is completed, they will give them the first choice,
right,
so that I think that will be the human face that can be added to. So I think let's do something about it before we lose life.
Of great concern, I would like to tie this in with the Teshi Link Road. 10 years ago, demolition were done along that stretch we're going to put up the street or the highway.
Right.
It's been 10 or 11 years down the line, and those whose houses were demolished, whether compensated or not, they still pass by and they see that, well, our house was demolished, but the road is still not complete. I fear that we may have a similar situation around that TDC area. What do you think?
I think there are a lot of plans to redevelop the place. Long ago, investors have come and gone, right? And there's a company in South Africa called MKP.
Okay.
I think you've been seeing them. They came over to try and do something about that place.
Okay.
They went far, but because of the legal implications and the fact that there was a court case going on, people left. So if the current TDC or director has got somebody there, it should be something that will be done immediately.
Okay.
But like you said, if we demolish it and then we go to sleep, you have vultures going there.
Right.
And I can agree with what you said earlier on. Are we ready to go? If you are ready to go, if you are not ready to go, then it's an act in futility.
Right.
You know, yeah.
I thank you. Richard, the vice president returned yesterday. Does that settle the dust finally? He was happy, he was hugging people and all of that. Does that settle the dust finally?
I don't know what the dust will be on, but obviously
the dust about the speculation.
I get your drift, especially
it's not my drift, drift
especially the comments of our brothers and Uncle Eddie and his team. But I think it was quite a refreshing news. I mean, seeing the vice president is looking very hearty, looking very fresh, ready to jump onto the work. I mean, we've known Dr. Mahmoud Bawumia over the years, and he's somebody that I admire greatly. I love him for this style of leadership and the kind of thing that he continues to do. Somebody who pays attention to details, the man who's ready to make sure that he deliver to the people of Ghana. He's somebody who doesn't sleep. The vice president hasn't really had even a week or two, or even 3 days of rest from 1998, since he was made a running mate to Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, and over the period from the various campaign moves to Supreme Court election to another election, he continuously to be there to offer his support and continue to work for the party and the government now that we are in power. And I mean, looking at him, it is obvious that he needed that moment of rest and needed that moment to sort of recuperate. Because the point is that for me as a person, I know when it comes to ill health, I mean, it's only God that control some of these things. But well, my brother, like we say in our camp parlance, a fresh tree can collapse right. or can pull down the same as an older tree. Mm. So when somebody is sick, what we pray for is that God continue to grant the person the strength and the good health. And I'm happy. And as a party and government, I think we are quite excited that the vice president is coming on board to look at the various things that we continue to push, the kind of promises that we made to the big people of this country. We needed him on board to continue to offer that sort of support to the president. Because being in charge of the economic management team and a whole lot of things that he is spearheading, I mean, with a tacit endorsement of the president, because this the president's dream and he's helping achieve the dreams of the president. From the paperless system, from making sure that passports are done within a shorter period of time, from making sure that documents, the registration of companies doesn't take ages, making sure that the various things that continue to become an impediment in the lives of the business community, lessening those things, making sure that at least we reduce interest rates, fighting the interest rates.
Someone said that the numbers that trooped to the airport to welcome him were totally unnecessary. Those are man hours that they could have used to solve issues.
I think I'm looking at the time that the vice president arrived. Mm. Obviously, I don't know how many offices will be running by that time. Mm. I mean, he got in, I think, quite late. BA, we know what time BA arrives. I mean, 9:30, 10 thereabouts. Mm. So is somebody talking about man hours? I'm not sure.
That it will have a ripple effect on today. So they spent a lot of time on the airport yesterday.
We in our house, I don't know anybody can predict what time Uncle Eddie sleeps or I sleep. Okay. We do all manner of things in our houses.
Well, and I'm not sure. I'm curious.
I continue to learn. I'm always reading. Okay. I'm learning.
Okay.
I mean, that's what I continue to do. Look at that. The mischief. So they understand. I'm sure looking at the time that he got into the country, I'm not sure that it will affect anybody in terms of how we conduct. It would even affect traffic because around that time, most people have actually gotten home. Mm. But the point is that as a country, this is our star. This is Ghana for you. Mm. This attitude of making sure that we will become each other's keeper. I'm sure if I hear Uncle Lady sick, I will troop to his house, will look for him, and go and be with him to make sure that at least we pick each other up and grow together and be strong together. That has been the Ghanaian attitude. I remember some time ago when the President Mills was not fine and he traveled and came back and people, I had no problem with it. Because the issue is that he has family. Yes, family, had loved ones, people have been seen for some period. People who heard all manner of things on the media, and they would want to be there to sort of solidarize with them and also let him know that they still care, they do care. I mean, so when people trip in, obviously you will love that. I mean, the president being there, it was important for the president to be there. The team of ministers and other individuals who were there, the media, obviously, you needed it for your work and all that. So we, all of that needed to be part of this whole thing to let the vice president know and also support, let the vice president and his team understand that we do care for him. I know the Christians were praying for him, Muslims were praying for him. Our brothers in the NDC, those without mischief and without malice, prayed fervently for the vice president's safe return. The others, though they were saying it, but you know that in their hearts, they were literally praying for the vice president. I mean, you can tell when people sit on radio and say one thing, when right after the program, the person is wishing the vice president well. You know that this is not what the person desired to do, but for the sake of politics, people would want to say things and try to create some disaffection here and there. But they as a country, there's one way that we can develop. The only way is that when we throw our political lenses aside, when we try to throw away our ethnic and get, we come together and allow one particular thing that binds us together as one people, that's being a Ghanaian. And that ought to drive whatever we do. We ought not to be divided by religious creed or ethnic divide or political affiliation or whatever it is. Let's allow the Ghanaianness sort of continue to drive our passion and continue to come together in unison and develop our country. And that's what we seek from our brothers.
The rumors were thwarted, so to speak. Some have said that yesterday the vice president, who was rumored to have had been down with stroke, and all of that were thwarted. He was fit out there, declared, and he says he'll get back to work on Monday. That ends the story, doesn't it?
You know what? As in this country, we haven't learned. And we do things that when parties are in opposition, they criticize. Mm. When they come to government, they do the same thing.
For example?
The photo opportunity you saw yesterday. Mm.
when President Mills was in that dilemma, and those things were, photo opportunities were given, you could hear the hue and cry of the opposition then. Man, I was all that you said. I mean, it's good that it was a very good memory. I'm very happy that you tried to remind him of what, in a subtle way, what they did
the
when
things that were said by
exactly.
Him.
And the same thing happened yesterday. Everybody trooped up to give the impression that the vice president, I wish him all the best of health. It's very important as the second gentleman of this country to be healthy. But the way we do our things, you know, as Richard was making his statement, analysis, he was alluding some mischievousness to NDC. No. We are not, or we did not criticize or talk about Baumia's, the president, Vice President Baumia's health. It is the way the government went about things. The various messages that was being given out
gave
the impression that there's something untoward happening. We don't know whom to believe. And that brought speculation. You see, recently Donald Trump, a medical doctor, went to examine him. People were saying that he was having some mental...
because of the way he was speaking.
Exactly. So after that, this doctor came, and for about, 2-3 hours, he gave the medical outline of Donald Trump. And he was subjected to questions. He was asked various questions. After he answered the questions, have you heard the American press talking about it?
No.
So what is best practices? If you look at other countries, the medical of the president or the vice president is very important to the people of the country. So they made the people of the country aware. And once the people are aware and the truth is told out, is told there, everybody goes
some
to sleep.
Say we are not politically matured to that point where we would like to play with somebody.
I just told you that we haven't learned. Exactly. That's what I told you, that we haven't learned anything. So we are doing, let's look our local language, Chaskele.
Okay.
You understand? Hey, that's what you are doing.
We're tossing it about.
Exactly. You know, so if we look at best practices, it's a growing democracy.
When are we getting there?
Well, we have to.
25 years.
25 years. I agree with you. It's very disheartening that after 25 years, we still be doing this, that a whole a vice president is coming, a whole cabinet, go and land a president, motorcade, we all over the place. I mean, and then the live coverage. I mean, come on. Even Jesus Christ, when he's coming, we are not going to have live coverage. Because Jesus Christ will come when we don't know that he is coming. You understand? So what are we doing to ourselves? You know,
maybe Jesus himself will do Facebook Live.
maybe. You see, so like you said, we have to learn and get this thing out of our body politic. You know, and know that, look, there are doctors, if there's a problem with the president or vice president or whatever, a very a good statement is made. You should allow the doctors to make those statements, not press secretaries. But even the write-up, after that, then somebody come and said that they didn't write it, then, and a whole gamut of confusion, you understand? So let us do, the man has got a doctor. The doctor should be allowed, or the state has got a doctor. I mean, when the president travels around, there's a doctor, there's an ambulance, there's the medical attaché. He is the person who should have made that statement, and end of the story, nobody is going to speculate whether he's got stroke or he's got that. You see, yesterday he was jumping on the platch on the.
Was he jumping?
But Hagen is jumping.
Oh yes.
Hagen is jumping. So
Hagen.
How do Hagen jump? He's making that jump.
Anyway, but of what concern has been the issue whether we have the facilities, and in fact, to borrow the MPP's words, they said that we have the men. In this country, the men will include doctors and professionals who will deal with it. Do we have the facilities, that your opinion, and the men to man the facilities so that we don't have a big man like you and trouble out?
If we knew what was wrong with him, then I can answer that question.
Right.
You understand? But we've got 37, we've got Ridge Hospital, which we Accra Regional Hospital. We've got the edifice sitting at Legon. right? I mean, go and we've got very good doctors, very good young. When you go outside this country, a lot of Ghanaian doctors are doing brilliantly outside. But before I can answer your question, one must know if it's only headache. And I mean, that one there, you just have to walk to the nearest chemist here and buy APC. I know they don't produce APC anymore, but Bluefield or whatever it is, and it will cure you. So we can only subject answers to when we know what kind of ailment he was suffering from. That if you don't have the facility here, then we could talk about it. But as far as I'm concerned, we've got brilliant doctors here. We've got good hospitals here. So I can only answer if I know what kind of ailment. Him coming yesterday and the way he was walking, I don't think there was something seriously for him to go and spend 12 days outside the country.
Richard, the facilities, the men, do we have them?
I think we do have the facilities.
So why didn't the vice president stay here?
I think you remember the release from the presidency was 2-in-1. That was a medical leave.
Right.
That includes some moment of rest or respite.
Just you could have gone to Holy Trinity Spa.
I do know that. But the point is that, like we all indicated.
Let me tell you something. Do you know VRA?
I know.
Have you seen the top of VRA?
Yeah.
Why don't you put some building there? Right. That before you get there, you have to cross the dam.
Yeah.
So if you're talking about medical leave, like my brother said, they just have to fly him.
But let's also know that.
How about the pediatric? You know, how about the pediatric lodge?
Forget about pediatric. I'm just giving an example. When you go to VR, and the top of VR.
The tower.
Let's also bear in mind that this is upon the recommendation by his medical team, his doctors who are Ghanaians. So it does appear that there were two things that he needed to achieve, a moment of rest and also a moment of further medical examination. I'm sure that that is not bad. I'm not sure anybody would say that is bad, because these are Ghanaian doctors who recommended that.
But the ordinary Ghanaian who vote for you, politicians, may not be able to afford that trip if they fall into the same situation. Don't you agree?
When we do that, then we are debasing the argument. The point is that we are looking at the president, the vice president, and I'm sure that during the era of President Muhammad, there were a couple of times that he visited the US and the UK and other areas just to see further medical advice. It helps.
Change has come. No, please.
Before President Dr. Bawumia became a vice president, obviously, if he was sick, he stays here, and the moment that he thinks he needs further medical examination, going out there. I'm sure Uncle D will do that. We all do that occasionally.
I don't do that.
Yeah, I'm not saying, as a country, a good number of people occasionally tries that. I mean, going on leave out there in the UK, what is it? I'm not sure there's anything that we need to spread heads over. The most important thing is that the vice president, number two gentleman of the land, was not feeling fine. He went out there based on the doctor's advice for a moment of rest and also further medical examination. By the grace of the Almighty God, the vice president is here, and I'm sure today the Muslim community will continuously pray for that. Christians will continue to pray on Sunday as well for the safe return of our vice president. That is what I think we should be interested in, because obviously, I'm sure that if it was supposed to cost even the country $100 million, if we could have saved the life of President Mills, I'm sure all of us would have agreed to it if it was even supposed to be sent to Pluto or Mars for such medical examinations. If we're sure that you could have guaranteed his life,
right.
Let's appreciate that. Let's not, debase the arguments. Let's not talk about, because the place that he went to, where he's been to, I've lived in UK for some time, I've lived in the US, I've schooled there and all that. I'm not sure there's any extraordinary place that if somebody is having a medical leave, workers, ordinary workers and all that, do go for leave and all that. So let's not overstretch it.
As a nation, a country, we should grow up. That's what I'm saying.
I agree with you.
If we have been doing this, as you are saying, over the years, when you were in opposition, this brouhaha will never happen. Right. But it is when we are in opposition, we are very good.
You see
the wrong or the right in other things. But eventually, life is continuous.
Right.
It will come and hit you in the face again. And I think
the difficulty with our brothers, our NDC family, is that, you see, during the era of President Mills, it was not that openness.
to carry Ghanaians along, because obviously President Mills would have enjoyed a lot of sympathy if Ghanaians had been towards it. At every point in time, there was some moment of denial.
Yeah,
remember when President Dr. Bawumia was not feeling fine, the president and the presidency and the government informed the good people of this country that the vice president is not feeling fine. Subsequently, another release came in to indicate that based on that, he had been advised by his medical team to go on a medical leave and for further examination out there in the UK. All this information were given to Ghanaians. When the moment of him moment came for him to return to the country, we were equally informed that by the good grace of God, he's fine now and he's coming safe to Ghana. All this information were put to the Ghana. But when it comes to President Mills, I'm not sure at any point in time. The first time I got to know that President Mills was not feeling fine, and I think people think that it is affecting his performance, well, from the NDC. I remember I first heard from Mr. Spiogabra and MTN talking about the fact that President Mills was not really fine and all that. As a government, NDC never admitted to the fact that the president was sick. Nobody said that. Nobody agreed to that. So we would all have cooperated and prayed for him. And even when he had gone out there and he had gone for medical examination and he came back, the kind of thing they put him through, making him drug and all those were things that people were really not happy about. Because indeed, the man has aged. Beyond that, he wasn't fine. And we knew that the president, no matter the situation, see, I might disagree with whoever it is who is the president of the country, but at the end of the day, this is the choice of the majority of the people, and see, I must respect.
Mr. Kuka, you hold a different view.
Very much so. During the time of Professor Mills, the government of the day made every effort to inform Ghanaians that he was having problems.
The denial wasn't there?
No. The mischief that was going on, it was the mischief that brought certain statements to be made. Just as we are here today. Government made a statement, but people said our vice had got stroke.
Right.
During those days.
Not the NDC saying it.
Oh. Allow it to make progress.
Richard, during those days, President Mills, everybody knew, had challenges, right? They saw his sons going a bit black.
Dhaka.
What happened? They started speculating. And government came to announce that the man is having challenges. But in our culture, what we don't do is that we don't go out to say exactly what the person is sick of. Right? That's the difference. Just as we are witnessing today, nobody has actually told us that the vice president is suffering from.
Do we need a national policy to push people to declare and perhaps to insist that our leaders stay here when they are ill?
Oh no, that you can't have a national policy.
Why can't we?
I mean, there are certain ailments that naturally
we can't have control.
We in this country probably will not have the equipment,
advanced medicine,
to handle it.
But that's why politicians are there. I
agree that we should, as a nation, make sure that those facilities are available here. That is why in the last government we built the University of Ghana, University of Ghana Medical School edifice. You know, and I was there when it was inaugurated, right? By the former president.
There's a tussle now.
You understand? And everything that you want to think about in this world, every ailment that you want to think about in this world, has got the facility there.
We're told the same thing about Ridge, the Accra Regional
Exactly.
Hospital. But why didn't we take the vice president?
So I agree with you that
when we are inaugurating these things, we say that this is a world class, top tier, all of that.
You ask the question whether there should be a national policy. And now I'm saying that would be far-fetched.
Mr. Kuka, would it not be contradictory if the politicians tell us at inauguration of these facilities that, look, this is world-class, this is top-tier,
yeah,
it has everything, yeah, and yet somebody has an ailment and we have to fly the person out? So what happened to the top-tier, yeah, world-class facility that we built?
I'm saying that as much as possible, we must make use of the facilities that we've got here, and we must strive as a nation to make sure that all the facilities that you have outside there should be here.
Okay.
Yeah, we must ensure that our leaders
are taken care of here. That much I agree with you.
I thank you very much, Richard. Let's move on. The finance minister, Ken Oforiatta, is heading to court to seek proper interpretation of the ruling given by last year by the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice in the never-ending 2.25 billion bond saga. According to the Ministry of Information, Siraj's decision to look into issues that were not part of those brought against the minister by opposition NDC activist Broja Jemfi is giving the opposition party the leeway to create all kinds of mischief. I'll start with you on this particular one. The issue of the 2.25 billion bond, it doesn't seem to be going away. And at every step, the plot thickens. Now Mr. Oforiatta says, look, enough is enough. I want to go to the court to tell me what Siraj did. Some are asking for his head. In fact, the minority in parliament are asking for his head. What do you say?
Thank you very much. I think it's like a football situation.
Between if Olympics.
If you are going to a match and you have a player like Messi or, say, Ronaldo in your team, I'm sure your opponent would find a way of seeking for him to be either injured or even will try and make sure that he's tackled so that he can sustain injury and will be out of the pitch or to destabilize him. That would be the situation. Because that point is that they've seen the sterling performance of the finance minister over the period and the sort of thing that he's been able to do, helping in taking away over more than 50% of the debt.
Irrespective of the fact that legitimate concerns.
I'm getting there, getting to making sure that those debts are paid, making sure that statutory payments are being met on time and what we came to meet are being paid, trying to make sure that there's some liberation within the financial sector. I think the NDC sees the fact that the backbone of this administration is how we're able to strengthen our economy, and the finance minister plays a big pivotal role. That is why there's this whole attack on him. The point is that what were the first instance, the issue that led them to strike? They were conflict talking about of conflict interest, of interest. Right. Siraj looked into it and Siraj said, you know what, based on these particular issues, you have no point. It is not sustainable. It has no basis. It's baseless to say the least, according to
then Siraj veers into areas that were not
and then Siraj veers into areas where they've not been invited into. But in terms of the administration of justice, if Siraj thought otherwise that beyond what has been put before it, well, the point is that you can't go to when you go to court and you're prosecuting matters on murder. You don't expect somebody, after the judge, in terms of the judge's judgment, then obiter dictum, they import another issue that is not even part of the substance of the case. And another
like
issue.
Like petty theft.
And then bring something in addition to that. It literally, and you do not grant the person the opportunity to answer or adduce evidence into the same. This is what happened. You went into the substantive issue, declared it that those things were baseless and they have no stance, they cannot stand in the case of law. And based on that, the finance minister has exonerated. Then you go into other matters and you fail to invite the finance minister to make an input, to seek for his concern, to ask for him to supply evidence to that. Then, you, based on your own thinking, you come up with a ruling or a judgment on that and pigeonhole him. And so that's the difficulty that, in one, did Siraj have the right to go to that extent and do that? If they had, why didn't they ask the finance minister to literally supply them with the necessary information, the relevant information? Why did they do that in the dark? In terms of not letting the vice president be in the know. So these are the difficulties that confront the work of the strike. And I support the finance minister 100% and his desire to go to court to seek that portion of strike's report ought to be expunged. But the point is that in the act of natural justice, what you seek to do is that you need to give people fair hearing. And in that principle, the finance minister was not giving fair hearing on those particular matters.
You think so?
Of course. And Siraj said it, that they did not call him, they did not ask him to supply information to that effect. What they did was just straight ahead, go ahead and say, you know what, ABC is also there, though it did not come before us, nobody put it before us, but we decided to go into it. However, we failed to invite the finance minister to address him. And those are the difficulties. And I think that Siraj
overstepped its bounds. Mm. Beyond that, Strage was unfair to the finance minister. Beyond that, tough Strage literally involved itself in some level of mischief. And I think that those things ought to be curtailed. And I think that the courts will be ready to look at this. And I'm sure the court is seized with the powers conditional mandate to look into it and make sure they make pronouncement on that. And in terms of expunging that part of the record that seek to attack the finance minister without allowing, you know, giving him a fair hearing. And I think that the finance minister is on the right.
The dynamic youth movement of Ghana in court, they are suing the, Ken Oforiatta, the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice, the Attorney General, and they're seeking reliefs, a declaration of guilt, the pronouncement of guilt, one. They are seeking a declaration of the interpretation of Article 284 of the 1992 Constitution, as disclosed between paragraph 3 of page 127 and 3 of 133. They are seeking a consequential order that the content of the report as specified in reliefs A and B be expunged from that report. So they are drawing along the lines of Ken Oforiatta, but they are still wanting to push him into the fire. Mr. Adekuka, I come to you. They have petitioned the Security and Exchange Commission first. And then Mr. Oforiatta says, look, this is all mischief. I'm going to the Supreme Court. Will this ever end?
Well, I think it is his right to go to the Supreme Court to defend himself. We should allow him to do that. You see, but the genesis of all this is the way this bond itself was put on board. Argument was that only one day notice was given. There was no transparency. Certain laws of this country were broken, right? That is why it is not going away. You rightly said so. If things were done... If things were done properly from day one, we will not be where we are. You know, there's no smoke without fire. Right. So, for the past almost one year, this thing has been dragging on when it started. And Shraj has made a ruling that has inducted the finance minister in certain aspects of the deal. He claims that, my brother says he was not, but I'll be surprised that in the deliberation of the matter by Shraj, they never, if you wrote to him to give, to produce documents. I'm very surprised. If Shraj did that, that's very serious. Yeah. You understand? I'll be very surprised that somebody has been accused of doing something. And when you are going to deliberate on the matter, you don't invite him. You don't ask questions.
I'll be surprised. Let me the argument. Sorry, just for a minute. You see, on the petition of Roger Jemfi, Mr. Oforiatta was served a copy.
Exactly, that was coming
and,
to that.
And his views were invited. But in terms of the other things that Strad decided to veer into, which was not part of the
impression,
Strad failed to invite Mr. Oforiatta to make an input.
I think that's where
is that possible?
Exactly,
that's why itself would be a human rights institution.
Exactly, that's the problem.
Would want to look
that's why everybody's questioning why did Shraj do that?
Because I know that.
We don't know that for a fact.
If Shraj,
as we've known them to operate, if you have an issue with Mr. Adekuka, they will call you and call him.
Remember a couple of years ago, even the Strike boss herself was found guilty on a couple of things.
They are human institutions, so let's not believe that we are infallible.
I think you're painting trash with a different brush.
Let's get this. You know, even in terms of
legal
in terms of even a legal system, that is why provision have been made for the various appellate processes to kick in when indeed one is not satisfied with one level of
trial, we always deal with both sides of the issue.
So that is why it's against the law. You go to Supreme Court for interpretation.
Mr. Kuka, I
was trying to remind Richard that when the petition was sent, I remember very well that Shraj sent a copy to Ken Oforiatta. Right. And then
They asked him to answer.
Right.
And we were told in the, I read the papers, that he has given Chirac a certain period of time that he was going to respond to those queries, the petition. So I'll be very surprised to hear that he was not given the chance, right? Whether extenuating circumstances or whatever has arisen that Chirac has added certain findings to the petition. I think as a human rights court, they got the right to go into areas that they think they deem is proper. If you feel that you have any challenges, then you have to go and appeal. But then we shouldn't say that what Chirac has done was no. Chirac has said that the whole transaction has a huge problem around it. Various laws of this country were broken. So it's up to him to go and defend himself. So when I hear people arguing that the minority is being mischievous, no.
The information ministry, in fact, Mr. Koka, and I'm quoting page 3 of the Daily Guide, says, "We understand the psychological effects they hope to attain by constantly assailing Ken Ofori-Atta. We understand the discomfort that the NDC feels when the great work that has been done in reordering the messy economic fundamentals that the NDC bequeathed to us. They have lost the argument on the proper management of the economy, and therefore they must attack the architect of this great work." The information
you
minister
see, what has changed in this country? The past 12 months, what has changed?
Nothing has changed.
84,000 people went to queue at immigration, 84,000 for 500 vacancies.
You did not employ them. You left them behind. And we are
employing them. What you are doing is that you are sacking people and replacing them. They are allocating jobs. Go to all the various state institutions. You sack the people who were there claiming that they were NDC people, and you have replaced them with MPP people.
Where do you know that this has happened? I'm curious.
Go to DVLA.
Okay.
Where is
that? DVLA here.
The boss of DVLA.
No, not the
boss.
Apart from the most boys who were working there, have been asked to go home, and you've taken your boys there.
You mean staff of DVLA?
Staff of DVLA. Go there and check. Go there and check. Look, I'm saying that the last time we asked the president how many jobs he has created, he told us he doesn't know.
He said the statistics are.
Please, he said he doesn't know. It would in the next 3 months he's going to tell us.
Right.
When Donald Trump went to even before he went to Congress, he was able to say that he has created X amount of employment. So when the thing that you read to me there, right? I asked a question. The last 12 months. What is the rate of the cedi to the dollar?
Right.
What's the rate of inflation? What is unemployment? Oh.
Allow him to speak.
Richard, you don't like him very much.
allow him to make his point.
You don't like him very much.
He allows you to make
your point. Exactly.
Exactly. So you are talking rate of inflation, GDP, you're talking the cedi. What else?
What? Unemployment. Price of petrol. Has it come down from 14 when they inherited? Where is it now? Roads. Look at the state of the roads. Hospitals. Like you said, if they had read to the police. So what has changed?
You said you had read to the hospital.
That is what we told Ghanaians, that look at the massive infrastructure that we put in place, and that we are going to continue. Where we have taken the country, we are going to continue.
So there's nothing like witch hunting.
No. So what you read to me, for me, is just a statement to give the impression that the man is a Maradona and that somebody is after him. No, we are not after him. We are asking for transparency. And it is at the onset of this bond issue, their own attorney general said she doesn't know anything about it. And you know that all these things must go to the Attorney General's office for proper, assessment or a legal entity should be put around it.
Right.
So nobody is attacking anybody. It is because of the way they themselves started the whole process. That is, they've sold other bonds since thereafter. Have you heard anybody talking about those things?
No.
So if the right thing is done, I don't think anybody will put up a query.
I thank you very much. Let's check out some of your messages here on WhatsApp. 0508235228. That's the WhatsApp line, and you can send us your messages as we make progress in that particular direction. Lots and lots of them, huh? Richard. Okay. Good morning. I love the discussion for today. Both parties are acting maturely. I agree with Adekoka. The health of the vice president is very important to the nation, but we don't have to make decibels of noise about it. Let's hold on with the messages from the back end so that we can make progress. MPP has learned from the mistakes, and that is why it has to be, and that's the way it has to be. Politics must not sit at the center of this country. Kweku Imina in Takrady. Good morning, TV3. Evidently and incontestably, the elephant has stepped on the chicken. That's unfair and unjust. Posterity will judge us all. The moves was in bad faith. The suspicion was geographically, regionally considered and motivated purely by us. Some parallel moves had happened at other regions, but he's the president, sat aloof and unconcerned. Stop the bias, stop the injustice, Musa Ibi. I'm sure he's talking about the Upper West Regional Minister who's being asked to be suspended. This family and friends government, Vice President Dr. Bamia throwing dust into people's eyes on falsehood figures. The president being now the clearing agent, clearing his appointee, is free on every issue. Johnny, today is increasing. Just go to the market and see. Even corn, we can't buy. Ask now. A ball of kinky today. Kojoki and USD is worried. Good morning, TV3. I'm happy that the Vice President of the Republic of Ghana is back and fit and kicking. I pray that the good Lord will continue to shower his blessings upon him to be more medically fit so that to take the economy of this country to the next level. His rousing welcome by the President and his entourage was a step in the right direction, and nobody should play mischief with it. Naji Gordon in Jirapa Upper West. Jagos in Sawam says, I think the issue of the finance minister by the minority leading members should be tackled and solved once and for all, because now the minority are calling for his removal and he has to clarify his innocence in this matter. So my advice to him is that the earlier the better, so he should try and clarify his name in all these accusations. I'm sure that's why Mr. Forieta is headed to the Supreme Court. Jagos from Sawam comes back to say, we thank God that at long last Dr. Bamia has returned home, and may he continue to heal him from any kind of sickness, whether spiritual or physical, because Ghana is not ready to mourn any soul again this time around. Good morning, Mr. Hughes and the panel. I'm highly impressed to see Vice President Dr. Bamia come back home last night. I may say democracy or politics in this country is not good at all, simply because people can predict for someone's death or sickness in the name of politics. Ghana, let's be devoid of that. Oscar Bozu, Solo, Georgia, Volta region. Greetings to you and your crew. The hallmark of MPP is hypocrisy and arrogance. Since when did MPP get to know that somebody's sickness is the person's confidentiality? They did worse things to former President John Atta Mills, and they even went ahead and wanted to know what killed the former president. So they should stop the hypocrisy and give us a break. Though I thank God for the life of the vice president, they should stop seizing health facilities and rather raise it to a standard so the poor Ghanaians can also access good health care in the country. Good morning, Johnny. I always find it difficult to understand the MPP party and their cohorts. Whenever something falls into their doorsteps, they all decide to defend hard. Please, MPP, leave Professor Tamils. He is resting with the Lord. The issue now is Bamia okay? Ghanaians want to know. What at all is this cantata display by the NPP, Adam Swale in Tamale? And good morning, Johnny. Tell Richard that he should stop struggling to defend the finance minister. The man said he's going to court. Let's allow him to go and see what the court will say. Prince, King, Brian inside Borai number 2. And the incompetent minority should leave our finance minister alone. The man will not resign today. He won't resign tomorrow. The minority should rather settle their difference. Mashud in Tamale. A lot more of your messages once they're stepping. I'm sure we can read them. But let's wrap up, gentlemen. Yesterday, the president cracked the whip. The Upper West Regional Minister has been asked to stay aside while investigations continue. Is it a good time? Is it good news to you, Mr. Adekoka? And is this what we want to see?
Well, the president has the prerogative to appoint or disappoint.
And in this matter, what that I know about is that some MPP members up north went to a NADMO office to beat up the NADMO director, etc., etc. And I think the president is seeing the wisdom of bringing his boys to order. I think I'm told that the Upper West minister, a regional minister, went to the police station to have those guys removed from the cells. Well, if that is what happened, then I think he hasn't behaved well, right. Seriously. He should have allowed the law to take its course. And the president is in the right direction. He said he's investigating. So we want this investigation. We want to know the outcome of the investigation within the shortest possible time. So that if he has to go back to work, if he's exonerated, he has to go back. If not, then the whip must be cracked.
Richard, if some will say that, well, yes, he's been asked to step aside, but other allegations have been made. And the president, as people are now calling him, clearing agent, he's cleared them. He's not asked them to step aside while
I'm sure even people have resigned in time past because of the
appointment. There was one deputy minister, Mr. Kwetu, who resigned. That's what I'm saying.
That's what I'm saying. The people have resigned in time.
It's
past.
One person. That's a fact.
Don't worry, I'm not arguing with you. Let me make my.
No, answer. So let's not say people. Let's educate our.
It might even go beyond even this administration.
I know.
So that's what I'm saying. That people have resigned in time past on based on misconduct.
I don't know those who have resigned.
That's what I'm saying. That my comments might predate even this administration.
And I'm saying on fact and authority that previous governments have not seen that. The only person we have seen resign is Mr. Kwetu.
I'm saying in our history, you know, there have been more individuals.
Give me an example.
I remember, I think during even in Nkrumah's era, there was somebody who resigned on principle. I've forgotten his name. Okay. When it comes to mind, I'll let you know.
Right.
I hope you're getting me. In our history, people have resigned based on certain issues that they think even did not fall in line with whatever their beliefs and systems are. I didn't ask the government and ask the president has shown strong indication to the people that the only way we can sustain our democracy is trying to make sure that we promote the rule of law. And promoting the rule of law demands that we allow the various state agencies to operate. If the police have been mandated to bring to bear law and order, we ought to allow them supply the needed information and supply the needed help. We cannot at any given time, as politicians or political actors, try and undermine the police or any state institution. I know my senior brother and a good friend, Mr. David Asante Pietu and his men, are doing some great and amazing work out there. A couple of weeks ago, some people lost their life as a result of wanting to help the state secure peace because of what they were doing. So if in the same vein, it has happened that people were misbehaving, and I just want to move away from this attitude where when things happen, we try to wear the political colors.
Right.
But if you allow that, a moment will come when armed robbers are coming to our houses, they will either wear NDC shirts or CPP shirts or MPP shirts, but they know that when moments come, MPP political commentators or actors will come in to defend them.
Right.
Criminals are criminals. Let's see crime as crime.
Right.
And let's deal with them in such manners. So if you're an MPP person, CPP person, or PPP person, and you go and misconduct yourself, and the law catches up with you, I would want us to see that these are people who are going to misconduct themselves. And the law ought to deal with them. And that ought to be the way forward. Because until we stop that, because the point is that we've seen, and I've been somebody who had really fought for some of these things. I remember I was involved in this Munti incident and all that because I thought that as a country, we ought to allow the law to work.
Right.
So if, based on the allegations and all the information we are hearing that the minister, then his conduct suggests that he was trying to impede the work of the police in terms of their investigation. And the president sees, and the president sees judgment is right, and I trust the president on any given day, on any decision. That you know what, we do not want to fuel this sort of conduct, this kind of behavior. That when people go and misconduct themselves, we want the law to deal with them. And if they are arrested and politicians will go in there with the intention of either trying to molest or manhandle or trying to even put fear in the police and all that, and this is the way forward to suspend and even when it be certain people misconduct themselves to the levels, sack them, I would be all for it. Because the point is that we need to create the continuous atmosphere and prevent the NDC and giving them a lot of examples to be citing.
Why
and
not? I think us, you're watching political.
And I say, as my brother, last point.
You are speaking nicely.
As members of the MPP, regardless of where you find yourself in this country, if you are within the hearing of my voice, in any part of the country, even the forgotten part of the country, let's understand one thing. The good people of this country voted for us to come and resolve problems and not to create problems.
Right.
The good people of this country gave us the mandate to solve the problems of the country.
Okay.
We are, all of us cannot be appointed or be given
the
opportunity at the first instance. Let's try and support the system. Let's not rock the boat. Let's work with the team.
Richard
Asante
is a member of the MPP's communication team. When you appointed minister, you have a chance to meet the press. You can speak. All right. But right now, we got to go. Thank you. Chairman Adekoka is the regional chairman of the National Democratic Congress. He's joined us here on behalf of his party. He's also a football enthusiast. One day we'll talk about Great Olympics shortly. Alhaji Hart, yes, condolences to his family. There were Hart supporters and there was Alhaji Hart, yes. And I have fond memories because my uncle, the late Marcus Hughes, you know, was is very close, very good. Yes. I was a small boy back then. We'll be back. Yeah, that's right. Small, if we do it one and one together, shoulder to shoulder, standing closer together, we'll be able to get there. We're talking climate change and solidarity. That's the name of the organization that's put together all of this amazing thing. Bossman Owusu has joined me. He's a knowledge management specialist, but he's not here alone. He's here with one of my favorites. In fact, the biggest export from Africa to the world in terms of music. A man whose music has been studied academically and on the musical landscape for a long time. He's a lyricist, he's a melodist, he's a musicologist in my own right. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Ochiame Kwame. Gentlemen.
Charlie, you know how to make a brother feel good.
You deserve it. How has it been for you, Chami? Happy New Year.
Charlie, we are here. It's been an amazing year.
It's good to see you again.
Yeah, good to see you.
Oh, Bossman, so we're talking climate change.
Yeah.
Why at this time?
Well, basically because climate change affects everybody. Climate change affects rainfall patterns. Mm. And once rainfall patterns are affected, it also has implications for crop yield or crop production. Mm. We all depend on food. Again, it has implications for even health.
Okay.
And even energy, the stability of our ecosystem. Mm. So with that, everyone should be concerned. And especially if you look at it from the point of view of communities, they live very close to forest.
Right.
We're talking about forest communities. Mm. Their livelihoods depend on the forest. Now, if climate change is affecting community livelihoods, what it means is that they end up getting poorer because they are largely farmers and they depend on rain for agriculture production. And so once there is erratic rainfall pattern, we know that the implications will be that dire. And so we need to step up the effort. We need to start engaging. We need to provide communities with knowledge. What is real is that they know the manifestations of climate change, but what they don't know is how to deal with it or how to adapt that.
We've been talking about climate change, we've been talking about global warming. Where are we now? Are we in the reds or are we still in the blue?
The picture is not too good. And we know that if we don't act, for instance, we are told that on average, the global temperature is rising in the ranging of 0.8 to 1 degree Celsius. Mm. And what that means is that over time, if we do not act now, over time, the increased temperature is going to affect water availability.
Okay.
It's also going to
melt. We are rationing water, by the way,
yes,
in Ghana.
It's also going to melt the glaciers. Mm. And once that begins to melt, it means we are going to have rising sea level. And that affects even a poor person somewhere in the Volta region who lives very close to the sea, because then it tends to take even their habitat.
I'll go to Ochiame shortly. Huge task you have. You need an ambassador, somebody to trumpet it. Why did you pick Ochiame Kwame above all the others?
Well, climate change discussion is a very serious one. And we need someone who is serious, to start with.
That's a deep statement.
That is a very deep statement. And we know it's a fact that Ochame Kwame is respected everywhere in Ghana. Both young and old respect him. Mm. He's one person who you would hardly hear any public censure against for using unacceptable language. Kwame is already doing certain things in the development realm. Mm. We are aware of his drive for, against hepatitis B. That is a development initiative. Mm. He's already doing something on tree planting with Koeka. He's also already been engaged by the Forestry Commission to drive home the issue of climate change. And you don't change a winning team. If Kwame is doing it so well, and you also want someone to bring his brand to bear on the climate change agenda. So Solidaridad felt that Ochame Kwame with the clout, with the seriousness that comes with his brand, will be a better ambassador. Hmm. And that is why we chose him.
Ochame Kwame wears a 17th century half bow and he wears a 21st century suit. So he appeals to both the young and old. Ochame, congratulations to you.
Thank you, bro.
How many ambassadorial roles now does this bring number to?
We can't count.
You can't count.
Yes, I've lost count because I started becoming an ambassador since 2009.
Right.
Yeah, I think it began with MTN.
And every year?
Every year there's a new, at least new two. We're from AU to international to, and now we're talking.
What's the trick?
The trick is to mean what you do and do it like you mean it. For example, I have come to align myself with climate change.
Right.
Until the end of the year in review, I am going to stay consistent to the course. So we have about 51 communities that we are to visit around between Braunhafer region and Western region.
Right.
And I'm going to make sure that at least I visit more than 60% of these communities.
Right.
And when your job is given to you and you do it wholeheartedly, there's a great opportunity that an onlooker who wants a serious person for a job will take you. So
what is in those regions, the Braunhafer in the Western region, that's drawing attention there? And what would you be doing there?
So five key points. In Braunhafer region, there's Mijashishie. There's bush burnings.
Right.
There's a lot of people cutting down trees for charcoal.
Okay.
So that we can cook with the charcoal and then come back to have no, you know. Apart from that, there's
illegal mining
in the Western region.
Producing cocoa in forest reserves. Exactly. We also have chainsaw operations.
Okay. So to sum it up, it is, let me say, wrong use of land and bad land use practices.
I see.
And I believe that what we are to do now is to bring the conversation to bear, is to find interesting ways of letting the pensive topic of climate change be interesting. I think it's about time, because when people go into the realms of 0.1 degrees Celsius, there's someone sitting in an air conditioner somewhere right now watching us in his car going to work, saying that, what has that got to do with me?
Yeah.
And there's somebody also somewhere in the farm thinking Celsius, who is that? You know, so I believe that it's time for us to break it down in the local language.
Certainly.
And meet the people at the at.
So that's what you'll be doing?
Yes,
you'll be
that's what
advocating I'll
be,
and talking
yes,
to the
we'll
people.
Be advocating. Beginning with doing a jingle that's going to become a video,
right,
which we're going to show on TV and use the public address systems in these communities to play a lot, to drive my fans to the table, to bring the girls and the boys also to the table. Apart from that, we are also what I've been doing with the Forestry Commission is going to primary schools all around Ghana.
Okay.
So that conversation is still happening at the private primary school level. And then with Solidaridad and DGM, we are meeting the people and engaging them.
The bigger picture, what do we hope to achieve by the close of? Do we have timelines, first of all?
Yes. So the project on which Kwame is serving as the ambassador is called the Ghana Dedicated Grant Mechanism for Local Communities. And basically seeks to place forest communities at the forefront of the fight against climate change by providing knowledge. We don't want any person living in the community to say that I didn't know that climate change had this and that effect on my livelihood. So we want to do everything possible to create awareness. And beyond the awareness creation, we also want to provide some form of grant. So that when people receive the knowledge, they can practice with it using the grant. Mm. And it is expected that this will help, you know, reduce the incidence of deforestation.
Okay.
But largely, it is also because we want to improve the livelihoods of the people.
Mm.
And so our tagline, that is the DGM project, is knowledge improves livelihood.
Mm.
And that is why ESG is a NIMDIRI
YIDIE.
Okay. Yes, and that's why the World Bank is very much aligned to this project.
Mm.
It's actually a World Bank project.
Okay.
Funded by the Climate Investment Fund,
okay.
And Solidaridad is implementing the project.
Chami, you have the final word. Back in the day, around 2001 or two, the trees along the Atamills High Street in front of National Lotteries were cut.
Yes.
I felt so sad about it. I don't know, but what would be your takeaway as you start this ambassadorial duty of yours to save all of us from climate change?
I believe that... it is true when they say the last tree dies, the last man dies. And as funny as it may sound, God in his own wisdom designed an exchange system where human beings take in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide.
Mm.
And these carbon dioxides can only be taken by trees.
Mm.
So when we cut all these trees down, what we are saying is that we want to keep taking in carbon dioxide, which is like choking ourselves.
Suicide.
Yes. So I think that we are all intelligent enough.
Mm.
We are all smart enough. And then we all want to enjoy life to our 80 and 100.
Right.
To the point that we would like to keep it. And beyond staying alive, this is basic living instance.
Okay.
Yes. Beyond staying alive, we also would like to leave something for our children.
And so, before.
So we are going to Sunyani next week
okay.
to go and launch this program because we said that we are going into the communities,
right.
Beginning with Sunyani on Tuesday. So we'll be in Sunyani.
Bossman Owusu is knowledge management specialist. He's also with Solidaridad. That's the group that's pushing this agenda of climate change. And Ochami Kwami is the unveiled ambassador. And you know what is Explorer. Ochami, I thank you very much and I wish you all the best in this endeavor.
Journey. Right.
We'll take a break here. We'll return shortly. But know that Talented Kids has started and Ochami Kwami has two talented kids. Says taking over from him is actually unseated Ochami Kwami. You should meet him in person and have a chat. After this break, there's more on Talented Kids. Welcome back. It's Friday and you know we have an amalgamation of talents that pass through on Friday. Jeffrey Naughty is a spoken word artist. Is ready to string words together beautifully to make it listen well. Hear him.
So, they say I speak the mind of the Hime, but I say my words are medicinal. So if you have enough lifespan, you can download these herbal medicine from the site of my medulla. Wait, if I box a rhyme where you feel me, note. It not be me what I do, it be something where they my inside where they control me. You see, at this age, I am not going to wait for a Tuesday to give you double portion of my words like pizza. At the avail my body give God, I believe he's going to use me. In fact, this is just a teaser. So Bae wants me to sing her love song. But these writers ain't speaking my mind not to dispute the fact that she's one of a kind. Me, I'm in love, but I'm not blind. And I know she wants to hear Davido's If on the repeat so she can twerk with words like, there is nothing above you, but hey, bae, there's a God who knew you and what's before you. And I'm sorry if I made all those unconscious confessions. See, then I was drunk and poison, but now I'm a man. And being a man doesn't mean I should step in the shoes of Bruno Mars and catch a grenade for you. See, me, I'm trying to spend some quality time with my maker so I can be your bae, yes, be your best available evidence. If you're thinking same, it's not a coincidence. Me, I didn't choose you. God knows what I like best. So put away all these love lyrics you want to hear because these writers don't know you. They think about their pocket first. It was a game of two. She played me and I played her too. But why does it look like I'm the best player? Remember when I told you love wasn't all about sex? At that material moment, your blood froze. It felt like a story that has been untold. What, bravo, you just uncovered a mineral more precious than gold. Then you dropped that line. Where have you been all my life? I've been selling Kaluuli and granite. Anyways, I have been on the school of Legon. You see me in the school's library, seated at the far end with my head buried in the player's manual. See, my reign was a memorable one like my brother's. You made me famous. Updating your competitors about our relationship status. Wait, what were you thinking? That I was different? Well, yes, I was different. You know me, I'm sick and tired of breaking hearts, so had to create an annex in your underground chamber. Assuming your brain was full to recollect what you've been through. You called it love when I was swimming in your pride. You had your eyes wide open, but my first line made you tipsy. See me, I am that goro with multiple hands, so I gave you a flawless victory. I am the reason why Davido can no more be a Ronaldo, because I've taken over. I'm the real shutter, exhibiting the logistics of a player. I heard you cursed me with a schnapp. Well, that was a bad move. See me, I'm smart. Me and my phone, we are one. I took memories of the fun we had and placed it on my smart. It's silly if you think I'm going to use this to blackmail you. Wait, is it because you're black you think I'm going to use this to nail you? Well, I just need memories I can feed on. I just need something that represents you I can lean on. See, I'm that toe you don't want to step on. I'm that fool with no expiring date. Wait, I broke your heart, so you're trying to give me an expiring date? You know at this stage of my piece, I would have gained so many haters than weight. But before you judge, please wait. She lied to me. She looked as though her hymen was intact. She was looking all Joycelyn Dumas. I was wondering how she could negotiate for more spare parts. Well, thanks to pills and creams. See, she wasn't the girl I was praying for, but she was the girl I was praying for. I wasn't in a relationship. It was like two captains in a Titanic ship. So you see, it was a game of two. She played me, and I played her too. But why does it look like I'm the best player? Jeffrey Naughty.
That's Jeffrey Naughty right there. I love that. Wonderful. But Jeffrey, how are you doing? It's been a long time.
I'm doing great.
Absolutely. You have a short film. I saw that preview of that sweet one there. Yeah. What is it about, really? Tell us.
I don't really want to go deep in it. I just want to brush through it.
Let's stay on the surface.
Yeah, sure. It's premiering today and tomorrow at the Jungle Bar, okay. Rockstone's office, at 7 p.m. and 8 p.m. Yeah, it's just
what is it about? Tell us what is it, a line or two.
It's a love short film. One of those things is actually talking about domestic violence and all that. Yeah.
So it's starting tonight tomorrow.
Yes. Please.
What time?
7 p.m. and 8 p.m.
Is it free?
No, 10 Ghana cedis only.
We make a contribution. I thank you very much indeed. I'm sure when we take a break at this point and return, we will be able to have that conversation. But I told you earlier about Talented Kids. Talented Kids is happening today. The auditions, crowd auditions are happening. We've had Takradi and Kumasi. Dr. Nanama Ajiman is out there with the kids. You want to cross over now and have a conversation with her as she checks out with the kids. And when we come back, Della Botry is in the house. The master flutist himself will share with us a little of his talent, the tip of the iceberg, and then we'll wrap up your Friday nice and easy here on New Day. Your WhatsApp messages, as always, 0508235228. If it's your birthday today, happy birthday to you. And as we get on into the weekend, know that at 3 p.m. today, Community Connect will be live on 3FM 92.7. We'll share with you the success stories that we have achieved since the beginning of January. The very latest will be the overspillage of septic tank at the Grandview Hotel in the Greater Accra Region. Let's take a look now at Talented Kids with Dr. Nanama Ajiman.
Beautiful. So we wish you all the best. How do you feel? Are you nervous? Are you scared?
We feel happy because you are here.
Speak up for them to all hear.
We feel happy because the time you are coming, you are holding Vim, so we are sure that by the grace of God, they'll take us.
Okay, so he says they are holding Vim, so they certainly will win. But let me talk to this young man here also. What's your name?
Michael Akable.
Michael. And what are you doing for Talented Kids?
I'm a rapper.
What talent are you
playing? I'm a rapper.
You are rapping?
What
rap is that? Can you give us a little of it?
Yes. Every mama gave it to her son. He gave it to me as a legend. I am a can in your hand and I retorted. Wash my clothes with all kinds of detergent. But I think this song for you is very ordinary.
That is just an excerpt, and indeed I'm loving it. So look out for this young man. He just may win Talented Kids. But I'm looking for the beautiful ladies, and I see two here. Let me see. Let me talk to them. Hello. What's your name?
My name is Shelly Sewa. Sewa. I'm powerful bracket too.
Wow, that's a lot of names. But what are you doing at Talented Kids? What is your talent?
I'm saying spoken word poetry.
You are saying spoken words. Oh, nice. So people, look out for this beautiful young girl. But of course, you see all the talents being displayed here. We certainly will give you a good show here at Talented Kids Accra Auditions. But let me finally talk to this young, beautiful lady. Sweetheart, what's your name?
Nelisa.
Sorry?
Nelisa.
Nelisa, what are you doing for Talented Kids?
Braiding.
You are reading.
Braiding.
Braiding what?
Crocheting.
You are crocheting. Is it hair? Wow. Do you have a sample of it here? Is that what is in your hair?
Yes.
Oh, it's beautiful. Just turn and let us see. So this is what you'll be exhibiting to us on Talented Kids. Did you do that yourself?
Yes.
Okay, so we wish you all the best. Certainly, as you can see here, do stay tuned in for the Accra auditions of Talented Kids, because we promise to give you a good show. Certainly, DJ Switch will not be the winner anymore because she's already won. But we're giving the opportunity to other children to also exhibit their talent here on Talented Kids Accra auditions. But let me say happy birthday to you out there, Jewel Boachi Yadom, from your mother and your father, Kofi B. Your mother is Auntie Kate. Enjoy your day. Stay blessed. Let me go back to studio to continue with New Day. Thank you.
And that's Dr. Nana Majima. They're hanging out with the very talented children, talented kids. The new season is coming up, and I'm excited because the stream of talents, as I saw today, as early as 4:30 a.m., the children were here already. I'm told the same thing happened in Azuqua, the same thing happened at Pipe, I know, in Takoradi. So we're in for a big bang. Last year was DJ Switch. Who's it going to be this year? Who takes home the cash and all the goodies that come along with it, the deals that come along with it? We're interested. If you are at home and you've got talent, or you have a child who's got talent, this is the time to pitch them up. Talented Kids here on TV3, and you know, we're the best any day, any time. But as I told you earlier, Della Botry is here. Della, welcome.
Thank you.
How are you doing?
I'm doing
good.
It's
been a long, long, long time.
You see you.
Okay, so before we get into anything, play something for me to enjoy. It's always a good time. Where have you been hiding?
I'm around. I'm always busy performing.
The new album that you've got.
Yeah? Sankofa.
Yes, Sankofa.
Yeah?
Sweet album.
Thank you very
much. When are you doing a public show?
What am I doing?
When are you doing a public show?
Now I am preparing to travel abroad for a jazz concert in Europe.
Okay.
So maybe when I come back, but I'm planning to do something.
Something at Alliance Francaise?
Alliance Francaise,
Black History Month. It should cross your mind to do something.
I will not be in the country, Black History Month. I'll be away.
Right.
So I'm thinking of when I come back in March, then I can plan something. But
I see.
We are planning to do something big in the Jita Vota region in March.
Okay.
I have some guests, 80 of some British organizations that are coming to Ghana.
Okay.
And they are going to help the people in the community. You know, so we'll be there to perform.
You'll
I
be
think
there.
Two occasions, 2 days. Yes.
Konu, you have a great voice. And
thank
I like
you
your kalimba.
Thank you.
Sweet, man.
Thank you. Thank
I wish you all the best.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
So, Dela, you take us away, I'm sure, while we wrap up. But thank you all very much, viewers, for watching. It's been a full week of work. We're grateful that you could give us company. And on behalf of the rest of the production team, thank you very much. Community Connect will be live on 3FM 92.7, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m., the award-winning show. Tune in, listen, and tell somebody to listen. My name is Johnny. He's on behalf of Nanama Ajiman and the rest of the crew. Thank you. Have a prom-pleasing weekend. And see you on Monday, hopefully. Dela, bo, tri, dela, bo, tri, dela, bo, tri.
Sounds of Africa, hear what the sounds.